Okay, great. So this was about reading. Now what happens on a write? So there are two ways that we can do at, you know, two choices amongst which we have to choose one, which is, should I write through? That is, should I write whatever I am writing into the cache, also into, say, I'm writing something into L1 cache. Should I simultaneously also write to L2 cache and then L3 cache and so on? Or should I write from L1 to L2 only at the time of replacement or another processor needing it? So the first one is called write through. This is called write back. Only when the block is only when the block is being removed that you will write back into the L2 cache. Otherwise, you do not spend energy in writing into the L2 cache. You only change one bit over there, whether a particular line is clean or it is dirty. Is that okay?
So what is clean and dirty?
The valid bit. If the valid bit is 1, we say, okay, it is clean. If the valid bit is put to 0, it means that the information in the level 2 cache is no longer valid. It is dirty now. If you want to access L2 cache from another processor, then L2 cache will place a request that I want to write back from L1 cache, and then it will give data to the other processor. Is this clear? Anything else?
So in write through, it will always be clean.
Write through would always be clean, yes. But it is a waste of energy also. Because a program may simply access and write into the L1 cache very frequently. So that is a waste of energy. Finally, if it is something that the processor just needs as a temporary storage, you don't want to go back and write into L2 cache every time. When the program ends, in the final calculation only you can decide to write in the L2 cache. Any questions?
I just had a question that the significance of this dirty bit is only when we are going through the write back scheme, because then only we have to check that whether the dirty bit is clean or not.
Yes and no, in the sense that let us say two cores are simultaneously using a particular data there. It can happen. Yes. Two cores can be using the same data. Now, one of the cores updated the data in its L1 cache, and also because there was a write back scheme, updated it through the write through scheme, updated it in the L2 cache. Now, the first processor, which was already using the same data, needs to know that, okay, now this data is no longer valid. So now L1 cache will have the dirty bit in it instead of the L2 cache. So dirty bit may still be needed because something else wrote into the L2 cache, and I now am aware that this data is invalid. Is that okay, Akash?
Yes, sir. Yes.
If something is written by processor in L1 that is same copied in L2. So how that same block in L2 become dirty?
No, L2 is not dirty.
L1.
But there was the other processor which was using the same data. Now it knows that okay, L2 has changed.
Okay.
And my contents are now dirty. So I need to read from the L2 again.
Got it.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, pros and cons of each under this particular section for the write through, it is said read misses cannot result in runs. Why is that so, sir? Because if there is any read miss in the L1 cache, then we look into the other cache hierarchy and finally the main memory. And if we have that, and once we retrieve the data from the main memory, aren't we supposed to place that in the complete cache hierarchy?
So if there is a read miss, what do? You go to the main memory, yes, let us say, or the next level of memory, and yes, read from there.
Yes, sir.
There are two processors again.
Yes, sir.
Processor one picked up the data, processor one had a read miss. It picked up the data and brought it into L2 cache and then also to the L1 cache of its own one. And it updated the L1 cache, let us say, 3 times.
Okay.
It did not use a write through policy. So the L2 cache remained old. It just had a dirty bit on the L2 cache.
Okay.
Now processor two wants to access the same data, the same line. L1 cache mein miss ho gaya, L2 cache pe pahunche, to L2 cache mein pahunch ke usne dekha yahan pe tag to match kar raha hai, lekin valid bit is saying that this data is dirty. So now you need to write into the L2 cache. But from where? Do you need to write from the main memory? No. Now you need to write from L1 cache into L2 cache. L1 cache of first processor into the L2 cache. That write you need to do.
Okay.
So it was a read miss, but it triggered a write operation from L1 cache to L2 cache. Had the first processor followed the write through policy, the read miss in processor 2 would have simply accessed L2 cache and given the output, because the updated data was already there inside the L2 cache.
Mm-hmm.
Are you able to see this?
But what happens if we don't have the updated data in L2 cache also at the point in time?
So then you'll have to get the updated data. No? That is where it is a miss.
Yes, sir. So now we go to the L3 cache.
That miss is not to be picked up from the main memory. That miss, because the valid bit is dirty, that miss means that you have to pick it up from the processor now.
Okay.
Are you able to see this?
It's not clear, sir. Still.
Okay, so someone else in the class can explain to Ranjit. Only Ranjit is asking this question, so I'm assuming others find it clear. Who can explain to Ranjit? Yes, Mohin.
Actually, I want to confirm that if the dirty bit status is reflecting that changes has been done by the processor. That's why we are not looking into main memory, right?
Yes. अरे एक्सप्लेन तो करो रंजित को
ओके सो फर्स्ट फर्स्ट प्रोसेसर चेंज द वैल्यू एंड इट वाज नॉट स्टोर्ड इन L2 एंड द सेकंड प्रोसेसर वाज ट्राइंग टू लुक इट एंड इट फाउंड डर्टी बिट इज हाई सो इंस्टेड ऑफ गोइंग टू मेन मेमोरी इट गो आस्क टू फर्स्ट प्रोसेसर टू अपडेट इन L2 बिकॉज इट वाज चेंज बाय हिम
Ranjit, समझ में आया नहीं आया
नो सर
ओके let me remove this and let me try to explain it again graphically. Let us say there are two processors, processor one and processor two, and they have a shared L2 cache. यहाँ नहीं बनाते, let me make a shared L2 cache here. There is an L1 cache here and there is an L1 cache here. Now, processor 1 fetched a particular data and brought it to the L2 cache, then brought it to the L1 cache and started to use this data. As it was running the program, it updated the content of the L1 cache. If my policy is write back, what happens? Okay, it updated the contents of the L1 cache and set the dirty bit to be high over here.
Okay.
It set the dirty bit to be high over here. Now, after some time, P2 wanted to access the same data, same address location. So what happens? P2 places a request to its L1 cache. There was a miss. So a read miss happened and it went to the L2 cache region to see if the information is available in L2 cache. To a pleasant surprise, that particular address was already there in the L2 cache. However, its valid bit was zero. So it is a dirty information there. Yahan tak clear hai?
Yes, sir.
So now what would the processor do? If the valid bit was one, then it would have simply read this data into the L1 cache over here also. Now, since valid bit is zero, it means this data is no longer valid. So now to be able to serve the request of the second processor, what do we need to do? To serve the request of the second processor, I need to go back to first processor, pick up data from L1 cache over here and write it into the L2 cache. So a read miss happened, but an inter-processor write operation got initiated. Had it been write through, then whatever L1 had updated, it would have updated L2 also. And when the other processor wanted to access, there was no conflict, no challenge. It was a seamless movement of data.
Okay.
Is this clear?
Understood. It's clear.
Okay. So now when you do a write through, how big a write buffer do you need? We realize that the access time of L1 cache will be different from access time of L2 cache, will be different from access time of L3 cache or main memory. That part is clear. All of us know this. Hello?
Yes, sir.
So, what is happening? When I want to write into the cache outside or to the main memory, then I wrote to the cache, but to write to the main memory, I will operate at a speed of the processor, which is say 550 megahertz, very slow processor. And it would write into the DRAM. Let us say it operates at 10 megahertz. Now what happens? The DRAM can write only in a time duration of 100 nanoseconds. Whereas my processor is operating at a speed of 2 nanoseconds. So 5 data may come, and over here I would have written only 1 data. Are you able to see this? So in such a setting, if I do not have any buffer to store, so I could read 5 words in this, but I can write over here only 1 word. So I need some buffer, local buffer, in which to save the contents that I want to write. So we need to have a write buffer, which is nothing else but a FIFO. Is it clear? Any questions?
So these buffers are there in the cache itself.
Next to the cache.
Okay.
In fact, not next to the cache. These buffers are there at the interface of the DRAM of the main memory.
Okay. Because the caches are very highly densely packed.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So that kind of brings us to the end of the section on caches. Before we move forward, I want to, so any questions still here?
Sir, write buffer size, how do we make sure that it would do not lose the data? It would not store all the data which are in the pipeline of events.
So we look at a few things over there. We look at a thing like what is the line size? What is the line size in the DRAM? What is the line size in the L2 cache or whatever lower level cache that you're talking about? So if, let us say, easy example, mein, if the DRAM would store 5 words in one line, then you just need a buffer entry of 4 or 5. Because all the 5 will be written into the DRAM in one go. However, if the DRAM write size is only, let us say, 2 or 3, that 3 words are written in one go, then what do you need? Then you realize that 5 words are coming, 3 will go out at a time. And we could then also put in a probability that what is the probability of write operations? And then we can estimate the total number of entries that we may be able to, or that we may require in the buffer there. So this is just a simple mathematical calculation where we find how many addresses or how many words are not getting written in the period in which L2 or in which the higher order or the main memory is writing. If you are generating more words than what are written in one line in that duration, then the buffer size needs to be larger. If the number of words that you are generating is the same as the line size, then that's no problem. Is that okay?
Yes, sir, almost.
So anything else about caches?
Sir, can we discuss something about this designer's nightmare if the story frequency is greater than? Does that mean that I'm writing at a very higher frequency and the DRAM is not able to store it?
Yeah. So Javi, jo maine bhi second example diya ki aap DRAM mein 3 words hi store kar paate ho, lekin yahan pe aap 5 words generate kar rahe ho. In every DRAM cycle.
That it keeps generating 5 words. Nahi to I can store them in FIFO, right? If it is for one.
Yeah. So what is important is that there will be no buffer overflow until the multiplication of number of words in a line of the DRAM and the frequency of the DRAM is greater than number of words in the number of words that can be read from the that the processor may want to write into the DRAM and the frequency of the DRAM. Example ke taur pe, let us say S processor into the frequency of the processor means 1 second mein itne sare writes karna chahega into word length, which is one, has to be less than frequency of DRAM into length line, which could be, let us say, 5. So humne kaha ye 50 thi, every 2 nanoseconds a new word was coming. This was 10 nanosecond, this was 10 megahertz. So every 100 nanoseconds a new, so let us say this was 20, theek hai? 50 megahertz keh rahe na, so that was 20 then. So every 100 nanoseconds one word was coming. So what happened? 50 megahertz into 1, and yahan pe 10 megahertz into 5. Because I said that DRAM is much wider than SRAM, that we have the cache that we have used. So as many words that are generated from the processor, they can all go into the DRAM. No challenges at all. Now let us say my processor frequency instead of 50 was 100. Now what happens? If my processor frequency was 100, then 100 million words are generated every cycle, every second. Let us say. If this was 10 megahertz and this was 5 only, how many can I write? 50 million only. So where do the remaining 50 million go? I will have to size my write buffer so big that the remaining 50 million should go there.
Yes. So there's no problem in that route, right? Because we already know what can be the maximum data that can come out.
Yeah, but then there is an excess time for this write buffer that comes into picture. There is an area penalty that comes with this write buffer. This doesn't come for free.
That is a problem.
Yeah, that is the problem. I have just to do it in my mind. I can do whatever I want to do. But in reality, it costs.
Okay.
There is extra power that is getting wasted. So many things are lost.
Yes.
Okay. Anything else?